I'm a designer. I'm living in Munich, which is a city in Germany. I work with a small team of designers on a center of the city on a former island, which was used to store the wood when it was shipped down the Alps. Of course, after some time, it was not used at this anymore. It was in a wood workshop, and it looked, when we shifted inside, it was looking like this this picture, and we were renovating it ourselves and transforming it into our space. I call myself an industrial designer, which implicates that I work with industry. And this is, I think, a very particularly interesting aspect, because that means our work is not created only by me or by my team. It is a collaboration with someone else. What is a big part of my motivation is to figure out what are the limitations of what's possible nowadays, and in this way to figure out what defines our life now. I had the opportunity to make an exhibition at, it was just inaugurated 4 weeks ago in Cologne, and it was so far, I think, the most demanding project. It was about to exhibit my experience somehow with the industry the last 15 years. The exhibition was taking place in a space called the MAC in Cologne. It's an old museum. It's built in the 50s on the ruins of an old monastery. It's by an architect called Schwarz. It's a huge space, and the entrance is three floors. And from an architectural perspective, it was clear that we need a huge structure which is going in this whole museum, combining all our projects and giving space in a sort of a mini cells, where we can exhibit our each individual project. It was clear when I make such an immense architecture in this room, it is becoming a project. So we are asking ourselves, can we use one of our older projects to make this architecture? So there was this idea of using tables and just replacing the short legs with some much longer ones. And this way we made actually an architecture which is like an exhibition underneath tables. So this is a test setup in my studio, which later on also became the image of the exhibition. And this is how the whole thing looked like. You can see that all the floors are connected and giving space to each project in an individual cell. This was possible because Rolf Hay, founder of Hay, and who is also like the producer of this project of us, which is like a, started as a shelving system, and later on, yeah, it's made for setting up yourself. It has a lot of very intelligent and features. It can be used as a single unit on the wall. It can also be, it's made from aluminum extrusion. It's extremely stable. It can make up to 2 meter wide shelves. And later on came with the feature to add tables to it. And this makes it like the backbone of our exhibition. So this was the final design. And you see my team setting up the exhibition like some few weeks ago in Cologne. The very important fact that we use a project and integrate it in this exhibition project was solving the problem on not only looking back on our work, but also creating a perspective to it. So from a retrospective to a perspective, because we are engaged already in something new. So what you can see is that we built a tower which is going through all the three floors, connecting all the projects in one structure. So let me jump back some 15 years. When I was just out of school, I studied in Stuttgart and was working for a couple of years in Constantin's studio, but just right after my diploma, I founded my studio. The first client we had was Rosenthal, like a German company for doing porcelain, and they had, of course, a factory visit. And the first thing, these slides are showing my first impressions. What I was really quite amazed is to what kind of perfection Rosenthal has driven porcelain manufacturing. I didn't see any kind of people working there. It was all done by robots, super automatized. The quality was really amazingly great. Quite strange that the project they asked me to do was not another porcelain series, but it was rather a cutlery. And Rosenthal has since years not produced cutlery anymore. They have not even own manufacturing of this. So Herbert Scheller is the head of product development at Rosenthal. He had to explain me how years ago at Rosenthal porcelain was manufactured. Me as a young designer, the first thing I had to learn is to make cutlery myself by hand. So it's quite an interesting experience to turn into a craftsman in order to make design Of course, I think it was a very interesting experience to do a tool by hand. Makes it already, I think it's a very intuitive way to work, not even using the computer, only at the last step, digitalizing it and bring it and transform it into an industrially produced cutlery made in China. I think it is strange to let someone produce cutlery who was actually using chopsticks to eat, but the exhibition was set up in such a way that didn't want to show the whole design process, but rather focus on what's really decisive for each project. We did in the same years, we did pots, we did go through the same trouble. It was, Rosenthal was not a pot manufacturer, but the owner of Rosenthal, which was Wedgwood, they were also buying Allclad, which is an American company, and they bought Spring, which is a Swiss company, and in the end, I landed up dealing with American engineers making a pot and Chinese manufacturers sending me faxes like this. The great thing about producing in China was it was giving Rosenthal a lot of opportunities. For instance, we could work on a piece of storage system using porcelain, using glass, using plastic, using a kind of a mechanism which I discovered when playing with a kind of a piece of concave, convex-shaped plastic and transforming this into an idea for a lid. Of course, since Rosenthal has no experience about using plastic, I was in a situation to experiment with plastic myself in the studio, and I had to build myself our own kind of small injection molding machine, which you can see here, and which worked as well enough to, in order to convince Rosenthal to invest in this tool for this lid. There was an idea for an orange squeezer, which is like having an alternative mechanism working as good as an electric one without using electricity, etc., etc. It was actually, this time I was very often in China, it was extremely inspiring. Same time, I did my first furniture project. The furniture company I was working for is Tonet, the oldest manufacturer of chairs, which is still existing. They produce these kind of things since 180 years. What I think was very interesting that till now, all these chairs were coming from one technology, which was bending wood. This was a very interesting experience because it means with one technology, with one process, you can make a huge family of products which are all somehow naturally connected together. And again, when they asked me to do a chair for them, I did not even get the opportunity to use this bend wood, but they wanted to use me, a modern, standardized technology, which was not even in their own factory, but which was produced in Hungary. So again, we started in the studio to figure out how to make a chair which looks like a Tonet product, but which is made in a totally new way. The company had a very good idea. They said we have to make the seat thick enough so we can combine underneath all the legs, you can see it here, and glue it together. And then it was, in a way, a very efficient way to make a furniture because the legs and the backrest handles are made from the same part, and it's only this kind of particular designed saddle which made a big difference. Another one project of this time was a project for Flöte Otto, another project in China. Flöte Otto was actually copying a seating furniture from Zanotta. They produced this kind of sack in a very cheap way in China. They fit it with beans, and then it was about us to somehow redesign this bean bag and to make it into a proper, more serious furniture. And the idea I had is to connect the inner skin with a kind of a structure. To industrialize this, we invented a kind of a hook which could HFB welded on the inner structure, and when you blow it up, you get a sofa out of it. So for the exhibition, we cut it off to visualize the idea of this product. So it's coming in a small flat pack, kind of cardboard, to Germany, then being filled up with these beans and transformed into a sofa. The same company produced another project from us. It was like a bag, family of bags, using the same textile, the same technology with welding, and make a kind of a family of bags out of it. What I found out during the first years is that as a designer, we are not designing within a given process. Actually, it's our great opportunity to even design the process. This was a family of seats which was produced from sheet metal, perforated in such a way that you can bend it by hand simultaneously. A machine couldn't actually do this bending, but in the combination of CNC technology and craft, it was possible to create a whole family of this kind of seating furniture. This project didn't start with sheet metal. It was starting with a version from expanded polypropylene within, which was pressed together with an aluminium tool. Another project, which is using also sheet metal, is Apon for Schönbuch, where a piece of sheet metal is first folded and then stretched into its shape, starting from wood, laser cut wood, stretched, dried, and of course the company didn't want to produce it like that, much too complicated. So our project was about this machine. We designed this machine which pulls this piece of metal out of the bending machine into its final product. Most important project in the first years was this for this kind of chair family for E15. It's a small company in Frankfurt, and they had basically tables, and we were supposed to design the chairs for that. We had no budget for any kind of tooling, so the idea was to use technology from gliders to use it for manufacturing a chair. You can see it's all handmade. And we use CNC technology in order to produce this kind of ribs on which the whole flat plywood is glued onto. The great thing if you design a technique, a process, is that you can make a whole family out of it. The real industry is using tools, which is making a big difference to crafts. And our first real industrial product was working with Wilcon on this chair. Again, the idea was to use sheet metal pressed to form a kind of a seating frame, very similar than car chassis are done. And the biggest challenge with this process, or with this project, was to convince Wilcon to invest into this chair. Our job was to make the prototype. What was very interesting for me in these years is that my job was not about creating only a shape, but it was rather about convincing people and showing that we can do such things. This is James Irvine, rest in peace, he died a few years ago. The great thing with sheet metal is it can be treated in all sorts of ways created, like you can galvanize it, you can spray paint it, you can powder coat this, etc. And the great advantage of a tool is that you can mass produce it. Another very interesting aspect of globalization is that we can work with industries from far away. This is a project we did with a Japanese company. It's actually not a company, but it's a city. In this city, 200 craftsmen are working all with porcelain since 400 years. And the way they work together is very interesting. They don't all are competitors, but they have all their very specific workshops dedicated to one technology, and we are able, as designers and with this project, to not work only for a specific manufacturer, but use the potential of the whole city. This project was initiated by two friends of mine that invited 16 designers in the last 2 years to make something with this company in order to bring the potential of this city and of these manufacturing possibilities on the market. What you see here is in my studio that we are trying to, or when we're designing these objects, using skills which I have actually learned at Rosenthal many years ago. This is plaster spinning. We make templates from aluminium and wood. It's a very beautiful part of my job. I love to do this, working with my hands, experimenting. And this is all necessary because the company that is actually producing is sitting so far away, so we have to find a way to simulate this in our studio. This has a very nice way that you open the lid when you just press on one edge and it opens up. And of course, the translation of our idea to with the craftsmen in Japan was not very simple. So they use our models, then they have to use, then they have to translate it in their kind of technology using their experience, because porcelain is, when it's burnt, it's shrinking and it's getting very soft. So this is the final result. Just got ready beginning of this year. It is an industrially manufactured porcelain service. It's stackable because we montaged the handles very high, so they don't, they stack in a very beautiful manner. Another project in Japan was the work together with Yamagishi-san. It's a project which was started from Japan Creative. Japan Creative is an organization that takes care about the Japanese craftsmanship and Japanese techniques, which are special for this country. And I think this is great that Japan has understood that craftsmanship has to be preserved and that has to be communicated. So they each time invite 3 designers to come to their country and to experiment with their material. So after seeing the museum and that in Japan, 2,000 years, people have explored this material, I thought the only way to do it as a German designer is doing it very, very basic. So I took the basic green bamboo, we just made some simple cuts inside it and transformed it into a small set of furniture for which became a trestle and a bench. The idea was to make it flat packed so it can be shipped from Japan all over the world. It's taking the elasticity of the material, and this kind of rope is going through a hole into the bamboo, and from underneath you can tighten the rope by just pulling, just turning it. Voila. By the way, we did a book on this exhibition. It was done by Mirko Borsche, graphic design by Mirko Borsche, issued by the museum and edited by Sandra Hofmeister. This is summing up all the experiences I collected the last 15 years with industry. So far, we have talked about globalization as one of the biggest influences, which I think is not only a threat for us designers, but which give us as designers the huge opportunity to not only design objects, but rather design a process. We have talked about industry and crafts. Digitalization has created a huge opportunity for us designers to directly control machines. And I would like to talk about the point number six, the invisible projects, which got also part of my exhibition project. Invisible projects are all these projects which never made it to the market. And I think as a designer trying to figure out what where the limits are of our times, I think it is totally okay to sometimes step over the limits, and then you just see it didn't work, probably means that you stepped over one of these borders. One of these interesting, I think probably the nicest project in during this time was working for Vorwerk, is a company that is producing this kind of Thermomix. I don't know if you know this machine in South Africa. It's like, it looks like a kitchen tool. It cuts and heats the food, and it's like actually a convenience machine. What I was interested in is to use display technology in a completely new way. I wanted to transform this whole machine into a media facade where the pot sits inside and it's controlled with an alternative way of movement. It was very much supported by the company. They even built fantastic prototypes, but a company that is so big and is having a democratic structure, what they did in the end is they put the whole thing on a market test and they asked the people if they can imagine to cook food in a machine which looks like that. And of course, it didn't pass. So I think as designers, it's difficult to work with companies that are democratic structured. I think what we need is an industry that it has the balls to say, we do that project also, it looks strange. So what we do now, the last years, is I'm trying to concentrate myself on an industry which is medium-sized, but which is industry, because it has proved that all my first projects, I did absolutely not earn any money with it. They're all big losses. You have, you know, the chairs and all these things I've seen, we earn a couple of hundred euros a month with it. It's like totally frustrating. So what I do now is we work for companies like Hay, work on such projects like this lamp project, which is basically focusing on two kind of aspects. The one is the sliding mechanism. It's a completely new way of adjusting the light without using mechanical parts, but a piece of plastic. And the other thing is that we had to focus on this kind of light tech, because initially we wanted to use halogen bulbs, but it was much too hot. So working with companies that have no manufacturing experience involves us designer very much in the technology. We have, and that's my experience, to show the company how it could be manufactured. So we land up designing heat sinks, we land up making temperature tests in the studio in order to create a light like this. This is called the rope trick. It's produced for Rong for Hay. It's available on the market since about 2 years. This is how it works.